entice any of these executives into spending more money to make sure that we can pump more, get more out of the ground. I mean, if you're saying your investment's good for the next decade.
I think he despises the investment class without realizing that everybody's part of the investment class. But that's the best. I mean, honestly, I remember bumping him on a train once, and he was so proud that he didn't own any stocks. Well, that was certainly a vindicated position last night in the State of the Union address. He hates us. He hates our network. He has an anti. Where's the anti? CNBC. I mean, he hates us. What can I do? You know, why don't we quintuple the tax on the buyback? Why don't we eliminate buybacks? It was just the hatred of people have done well.
All the industry should be, I don't know, maybe we should, maybe the oil companies are like utilities, and maybe the government should run the oil companies.
I'm taking the under on the oil after that. I take the under. 8 year.
Maybe all what for profit. For,
yeah.
I mean, they are all trying for profits. I mean, he's right about that. All these companies.
It's rapacious capitalists.
All these companies are trying to maximize their profits. All of them. I mean, what do you say when that's a fact? There's really very little you can say after that. You acknowledge that.
I acknowledge that. And I also acknowledge that they seem to be very happy to take every possible incentive.
They do, then change the incentive.
And everything that
possibly. Fine, then change the tax law.
And who's lobbying for it, too, by the way? So let's just.
On both sides. They're the most popular job post-politics.
In just a few minutes. Thank you.
Did
by the way, folks,
ChatGPT write this?
RBC's Amy Wu Silverman. She'll be talking to us about the markets.
Looking for something like this?
Superheroes are everywhere. In our movies, communities, and running our small businesses. And they can grow online securely with MasterCard tools, extending their reach far beyond the storefront. Because when you see the superhero you can be, that's priceless. MasterCard is proud to support Black Panther Wakanda Forever.
Why is there so much space? Are we getting a dragon?
The Volkswagen Atlas, with more cargo volume than the Honda Pilot. Visit your local dealer today to learn more about our carefree coverage suite, standard on all 2023 Volkswagen models.
BetterHelp provides various options to connect with your therapist.
We can do this via video, we can do this as a chat, we can do this over the phone. So whatever is most convenient for the client is really what's going to help them open up more at the end of the day.
I have learned that I really do believe in the best of people. And I do really believe that people are stronger sometimes than they think they are even themselves.
This is where it all happens.
We're in your neighborhoods, working for you with a focus to dig deeper.
Getting the whole story from Gainesville to Jonesboro in Dallas and Stone Mountain.
Channel 2 Action News, live at 4, 5, and 6.
Georgia is really the Southern culture that I grew up with, is pride, this ability to see everyone as a friend. I want you to come each and every day and feel like you're with a friend. I invite you to join me every day at 3 on WSB TV, Channel 2.
Tank 101.
You're killing it.
Negotiate.
$200,000 for 10% equity in my company.
Like a shark.
I'll give you the $200,000 for 20%.
$200,000 for 20%.
A lot of these squabbles.
I'm interested. I like this.
$200,000 for 20%.
We're splitting it three ways.
No.
Are you willing to go down 15% for $200,000?
Do we have a deal or are you going to continue negotiating?
Raise your entrepreneur IQ. Watch Shark Tank Sunday through Thursday at 7 Eastern. CNBC.
Back to Squawk. We're just about a half an hour till the opening bell right here on Wall Street. We're really not on Wall Street. We're in Times Square, but Wall Street's down there. We're going to talk more about the markets right now with Amy Wu Silverman, head of derivative strategy at RBC Capital Markets. We're all trying to figure out what to do, and I'm curious if your view changed at all about the trajectory given what Jay Powell said yesterday afternoon.
You know, it really didn't. If anything, the
You know, in the near term, the options market certainly has been rambunctious. It almost felt a little bit like the pandemic kind of YOLO meme stock craze. We saw so much call buying, but you know, it's a tale of two tenors. So short term, there was a lot of bullishness, but longer term, you know, folks are starting to hedge more. That uptick is happening.
And the question is, who's going to be right? And historically, when you've seen this kind of price action, what's happened?
You know, historically, it's more the bears than the bulls. But I will tell you, the one difference now is for the last 10 years, there hasn't been a real alternative, right? Whereas now, you know, if you really are concerned about the market, you can just put it in cash, and cash is a real asset. So I think that's the one nuance to right now.
Hey, Amy, hang on. Because, a legend just walked into the studio. Steve Wozniak just walked in right now. Can we get Steve a microphone? I apologize, Amy. I had an Apple IIgs with his signature on it as a child. So this is sort of a very cool thing to have you here. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Is this microphone working?
It is working. How are you doing?
I was joking. I'm doing great.
What are you doing here?
Let's see. What am I doing here? I'm actually, I do public speaking now, and I'm speaking for NBC Universal and visiting them and
fabulous.
Meeting some great people. Yes.
Ringing the opening bell. Steve, I was just telling Linda Yaccarino, sorry, Becky Quick, nice to see you. I was just telling her that you were.
You're going to interview Becky now. Look at this.
Great ratings for us in the 6 a.m. when we could never get anybody in the 6 a.m. You came on and everything took off.
Oh, I like that. I hear things like that a lot, but
Steve, since we're here and we've just so rudely interrupted Amy, who's our guest, but you've just become our guest. ChatGPT, we've been talking about it all day and morning and week and month now. As the great innovator that you are, is it game-changing or not?
I've spent an entire lifetime really studying brain computers. The computer will never equal the brain. We don't know how the brain is wired. I was a psychology major when I took my final year of college to get my degree. And we don't know where our memories are. We don't know that they're in the brain. We know the processing centers are in the brain.
Right.
We just don't know the memories. A lot of these things, so I was very negative at first on any, any human-made technology being equivalent to nature. So it'll never be equal to, good Lord, look at a lot of AI examples where you drive a car and try to make the whole decisions the dumbest driver in the world wouldn't make.
Right.
But now ChatGPT, it's just so, it's just kind of so impressive. But, you know, when a machine could beat a human at chess, we said the same sort of things. Oh my gosh, it's so smart, you know. And it's just following different methods than a brain follows.
So you're now being able to still,
you know, we want a humanist that has some emotion and feeling about things and, you know, about subjects. You can really get turned on with them.
It's still going to be a while, I think. Yeah, it's still going to be a while before we
he just wants to be better than Siri.
So I think it's going to be useful to humans
thought.
As all computer technology. AI is the high end of it, where it follows procedures to learn things. You know, you can scan, if you can scan things, you know, a billion times a second, no human could ever come close to memorizing what you can.
Yep.
And then, you know, and given instructions of how to go, you know, we go and we borrow things that are online for it to go look online and find out what fits the category of the keywords. It's pretty impressive, but the trouble is it does good things for us, but it can make horrible mistakes by not knowing what humanness is. I mean, just like if you're driving a car, you know, and you know what other cars might be about to do right now because you know humans.
Right. The Woz, we want to thank you for just popping in like this.
Oh, yeah.
I know
thank
this
you.
Is a little
I'm
unusual.
I'm just here by accident.
Becky's microphone. We're over time.
Amy Wu, Silverman, we're going to have you back maybe tomorrow.
Maybe
we'll have you back tomorrow. And you join us tomorrow and you'll see Amy. Spock on the Street is next. We apologize. Cool.
Good Wednesday morning. Welcome to Squawk on the Street. I'm Carl Quintanilla with Jim Cramer at the New York Stock Exchange. David Faber is going to join us in a moment. Pre-market giving back some of yesterday's rally as we dive into some consumer names today. At least five Fed speakers after Chair Powell's remarks on inflation on Tuesday as well. Our roadmap is going to begin, though, with trouble in deal land. British regulators say Microsoft's Activision takeover could harm gamers. Plus the consumer checkup. Chipotle sees customers pulling back. Uber with its strongest quarter ever. And Yum Brands CEO David Gibbs is going to join us exclusively this hour. And then both Zoom and eBay join the ranks of tech companies announcing some significant layoffs. Let's begin, though, with Microsoft Activision. The UK's Competition and Markets Authority says its investigation found that a merger between the two would stifle competition and harm gamers. The antitrust watchdog expressing concerns about cloud and console gaming. Microsoft says it is committed to assuaging the regulators' concerns, while Activision says it hopes it'll be able to help the CMA better understand the industry. Jim, continued pushback on all this regulatory pressure.
Yeah, this deal is going to fail. And I think we all have to own it. Yesterday, Bobby Kotick put up a spirit of defense. But look, they don't like the deal. I mean, this is like the Simon Schuster deal they didn't like. These regulators are different now, whether they're Britain or here. They just think that everybody's a loser want a combination who's not a shareholder. And Britain's no different from us. They feel that this hurts gamers. Now, to some degree, it's almost impossible to believe this happened. That the gamer class has to be protected. Of the different groups that need to be protected, I'm putting the gamers not very high. But they might, it's the writers in the Simon Schuster, here's the gamers, less choice. But I think that the companies in this country, and they have to start recognizing that regulators don't like deals, whether it be the Russians with the DuPont-Rogers deal or this. They don't like deals. It's a new world. And you got to be careful when the regulators block you. But this is a new low in terms of who they're trying to
protect. Yeah, for sure. Of course, Faber was early in helping us concentrate on the UK element of all of this. And David joins us on the phone, I think, from the road today. David, what do you think of this latest chapter?
Yeah, thanks, guys. Sorry for the background noise. I'm at an airport. But, to quote the Princess Bride, I think after checking with any number of people who obviously analyzed these things and have taken a close look at the notice of remedies, summary, and everything else, they probably say this deal's mostly dead. Not entirely dead. Maybe it can be brought back to life in some way, but it seems unexpected. Hard to put percentages on it, but I've asked people and gotten anywhere from 75 to 90%. They think the chances are against the Microsoft being able to figure out a way to meet the objections of the UK regulators while still preserving the value of the deal itself. They point to paragraph 44 of the notice of remedies, which would seem to be very hard to get around in terms of what the UK is looking at as a substantial lessening of competition. One bright note perhaps cited though is 27B, paragraph 27B of the summary, where at least they do point to a team with emerging cloud area as being the main area of concern. But what's interesting, and to Jim's point in a sense, is these regulators and where they are right now, there is no the market doesn't exist. You can't stream Call of Duty right now. So they're talking about something that doesn't exist and they're objecting to it, potentially. And the question for Microsoft would become, could you sever off Call of Duty in the UK? Very hard to imagine. Are there other assets that you could sell to meet these regulators' concerns? Hard to know. Can you do a 15-year deal with Sony to allow them for streaming a cloud, for a cloud-based service? Maybe, but is that going to be enough? So, guys, it would seem that this is a very significant moment for Microsoft in terms of really making a decision here as what it wants to do, as it faces significant opposition from regulators in the UK. Doesn't mean it's completely dead, but as I said, it does seem to be, let's call it, mostly dead.
Yeah, David, the protected class of gamers, I know there's been a lawsuit in Northern California. They're talking about how this would foreclose rivals, limit output, reduce consumer choice.
I think that 5% number is pretty good. I know you've discussed Chat GPT. We did it this morning, even, and AI a bit recently. Is there a way to trade any of this? My personal feeling is that it's getting close to a bit overdone.
I think it's getting to be a bit overdone, too. I'm going back and forth with a few customers talking about, in relation to the old Bitcoin, but how far is too overdone? This, we could be in the infancy of it. For me, I think I just got to look at each individual, since there's no really good like Chat GPT stock to trade with. I think you just have to look at each individual's IV rank and stick to the mechanics.
Yeah, I am. I agree with the bat. My personal feeling is that whatever that stock was this morning.
It's 3 months ago, I didn't, hear about it. Now I hear about it every moment.
What was that stock you were talking about this morning?
Vanetta brought it up?
Yeah,
I brought up Nvidia and a few others.
No, there was one stock. Was it AO? I forgot which one it was already. I've never traded it. It's that $25 stock. You brought it up this morning.
It was AI. It's that C3 AI ordinary.
It went from $12 to $25.
Yeah.
It is very hard for us when a stock goes from like $12 to $25 to say it's not a bit overdone. You know,
could it go to in a week? Yeah.
In a week. Could it go to 50? Of course. You know, we've gotten in trouble for this before.
Yeah, of course.
We haven't, you know, even Microsoft's done some crazy stuff recently.
Yeah, Microsoft was supposed to have softer earnings, all the other crap, but there, yes.
Yeah, my feeling is that it's been an incredible move. I would rather trade it using, like, I feel better using Microsoft, and I'd rather, you know, I do feel it's a bit overdone. I'm thinking about getting short Microsoft on the opening today. Mm. It was up about $3 pre-market, but I don't know.
It's up about $5.
There you go.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go to the next slide and the last one. I heard the bond market is where smart money is, and we should take our cues from it. Bonds have been declining, so if bonds are where the smart money is, then are these stock dip buyers going to get their faces ripped off?
I've always heard bond market traders were knuckle draggers. Tom?
So what I wrote back to this person is, I'm not sure where you heard that the bond market is smart money, but I would argue the opposite. First of all, I don't think there's such a thing as smart money. I never thought there was such a thing as smart money.
In any market,
any market, stocks, bonds, whatever else it is. You know, I don't care who it is. I mean, is SoftBank smart money? I doubt it. You know, is anybody else out there that, you know, I mean, prove to me that there's such a thing as smart money. So I don't believe in the concept of smart money. But if there is smart money, it's definitely not in the bond market. That's my feeling. So, I mean, the fact that bonds have been declining, and I don't, you know, it doesn't mean a damn thing to me about, you know, stock dip buyers. I mean, not a single thing. When people read that or hear that or ask that question, you just need more experience. More experience will get you way past worrying about, you know, the bonds being smart money.
Very good, sir. Let's take a quick 90-second break and come back. We got more Tasty Live coming up with you. Option Jive next.
Hey, you. Yeah, you. You deserve a big bonus and a better broker. Now, when you open and fund a Tastyworks account, you can get up to $2,000. Have it all with Tastyworks. Low rates, lightning fast technology, a live in-app trade feed, and award-winning support. You deserve it all, and you can get it. Plus, up to $2,000 when you trade with Tastyworks. Head to tastyworks.com/tasty-offer for more details.
Hi, I'm Tom. You may have noticed some things look different around here. Yes, my intermittent fasting is working, but also our Tasty brand is expanding. Our free 10 hours of daily programming will now be known as Tasty Live. So while things might look a little different on screen, we're still bringing you engaging, hardcore, holistic content that's not offered anywhere else. You're watching Tasty Live, the Traders on Network.
Drugs. He also joins our roundtable and shares with us his best investment ever on Shark Tank. I hope it was the best for you. Plus, could an obesity drug reach $100 billion in sales? We look at all the blockbuster drugs that are hitting the streets in 2023. Eloquist, Cialis, Jeftana, the hottest dancers at the club, or drug names? I do a deep dive into how they name drugs. Caution, this story may cause explosive laughter. In Trends, we look at the medicinal side.